Hi, I'm Elizabeth Greenberg, Dean and Director of Education at Maine Media Workshops and College in Rockport, Maine. Storytelling has been at the heart of Maine Media for 40 years. Documenting and archiving the stories of Maine through photography and filmmaking is a way for us to give back and to be a part of our Maine community. Our students come from Maine and from around the world to learn the craft of image making and to be part of a community that is passionate about creativity and the art of storytelling. Everyone has a story, and these are the stories from Maine. Our first story is about a lake, a warden, and learning to slow down.
I grew up on the lake. My grandparents had a cottage here. Ever since I could swim, I've been swimming and fishing and boating, and it's just a beautiful place, as Maine has many beautiful lakes and ponds. People have to remember that things that are done miles away from a lake have an effect on a body of water. We're the McGunnacook Watershed Association, and this is a 32 square mile watershed. So in essence, something that someone does anywhere within the watershed can have an adverse impact on the water quality. The Secchi disc reading, and which is that the round white and black disc, is probably one of the best indicators of a lake's health. 1 or 2 years of Secchi disc testing doesn't really tell you much. What you're looking for are trends. Is the water getting clearer? Are the readings getting shallower, deeper? You know, which way is the lake going? And if a trend starts to develop with the Secchi disc, you can start taking some other tests to see, you know, okay, we know the visibility is changing. Why? In Maine, lakes and ponds belong to the people of the state, and it's our job, not just mine in an official capacity, but everybody who canoes, kayaks, fishes, enjoys our lakes and waters, to do what they can to preserve them, preserve the quality, and make sure that future generations can enjoy the same things that we are. Yesterday, I had my 2-week-old grandson up to the cottage on the lake, and I want him to have the same enjoyment, the same clean water to swim in that I've had and my parents and my grandparents before me. Three years ago, after being diagnosed with terminal cancer, you gain a greater appreciation for what you have. And I think everybody in this world, our techno world today, has to slow down, use the old expression, slow down and smell the roses. You know, enjoy every day, enjoy every sunrise, every sunset, and if it happens to be raining cats and dogs, enjoy that too. When you get that sort of a diagnosis, you know, your tendency is to just, you know, give up. And then, I don't know when it dawned on me, it was a few months into it, I said, no, I'm not going to sit in the recliner and wait for it to happen. So we just do the best we can, have a ball every day, and see what happens tomorrow. There you go, hi buddy. Every time you turn the corner, you never know what you're going to see.
Life can take many unexpected turns. For example, how a man who planned on becoming a doctor wound up starting a zoo in Maine.
Thank you. Hey, I can do without your mouth. Thank you. Hey, hey, where's my pretty kitty? Oh, where's my pretty kitty? Oh, where's your pretty kitty? Oh, yes, I love my kitty. Oh, Scott. Of course, if you understand where I've been, what's happened to me in the past, it kind of destroyed me.
Bob started the farm in 1980. He's a Vietnam vet, and he was studying to be a doctor. Had three strokes and a heart attack due to Vietnam. Can't read, can't write, can't think straight, can't communicate properly. He went to a restaurant. He always went to the same restaurant, sat in the same booth, ordered the same thing, so they knew him, so he didn't even have to talk.
When I started this, I mean, I was just a basket case. I was nothing, and then these guys have kind of brought me back to society. I'm back so I can talk to people again.
These animals definitely have saved his life.
I like to move it, move it. Come on, guys, sing. I like to move it, move it. Come on, dance. Come on, dance, guys. Come on. I like to move it, move it. What do you like, Allie? Allie, what do you like?
Now, I was a woman that was very housebound. I wasn't allowed to go out, and I was getting out of a really bad marriage. And I came in 17 years ago on a field trip with my daughter. He said something about volunteering at the field trip. So I was like, okay, what's it entail to volunteer? He says, clean up, clean up, clean up.
I told her the job was three things, picking up, picking up, and picking up.
He said, be here at 8. I was there at 8. He wasn't at the gate yet. It was locked. I had to wait for him to get up. He didn't think I was coming. So he gave me the back pasture to rake all by myself, which was probably at least a half acre land. And I raked it, all of it. My hands were bleeding. He said to a friend of his he was talking to, I'll never see her again, because he put Band-Aids on my hands when I left. And we worked together really well. I'm a hard worker. He's a hard worker. He's a flirt. I told him I'm not interested. I was getting out of a bad marriage. And he's like, okay. So I married him 6 months later.
I lied to her. It was four things. She's picking up after me now. Some person asked me, a couple weeks ago, what drives you? And Seattle. Wow. I mean, you can't understand. I mean, the closeness that these animals have, and they wouldn't have it if I wasn't here. That's why I have Taiki as a blind tiger. And that's why I have one with no tail. That's why I have these animals that, hey, just because they aren't fortunate enough to be 100%, why should they be euthanized? And I want people to understand them. And this is the whole thing.
Some people discover their passion early in life and pursue it. In Rockland, Maine, young dancers can find the joy of movement even if they don't aspire to be prima ballerinas.
I feel like I was made for this. I feel like I was made to dance. And if I'm not, or if I didn't pursue it, I wouldn't be who I am. I'd be like denying who I am.
Get right up. Let me see. And these are your slippers?
For me, I live to dance. If I'm not dancing, I mean, I'm still happy, but dancing brings me such joy inside that I need it.
Releve was really hard for me yesterday, weight up on my toes. So right now I'm not putting any weight on this foot.
One of the things to get really strong is to do this. Okay, so you want to stand like this. So make sure you bend your feet, but get up as high as you can. And releve up, arm up, other arm up, and balance.
I enjoy the discipline of ballet. I find it fun. It's fun in a different way.
Ow!
Second, and down. Good, stand nice and tall.
I'm not, 15 anymore. And that's okay. Admit anyone into my dance studio. I teach all kinds of kids. Kids that want to become prima ballerinas or think they want to. Kids that have no interest in doing that and don't want to go to another studio where that's all it's about. You know, if you can't do this and this, you're not welcome here because you're never going to make it. And so they come to me. I teach everybody. I teach anybody who just wants to take dance. I love being with children. I love to see them learn. I love to see them, you know, trying something, whether or not they get it right. They eventually do. And I don't know what that does. It sparks something in me to see that happen. See what they can do now versus what they did when they were three. It's just beautiful. It brings me great joy to watch them progress. In 10 years or later, I would like to still be doing this.
Walk. Don't let your circle shrink. You should get behind me. Walk, 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 walk. Open your circle bigger.
Many people see rock climbing as a high-risk sport, but this Maine Climbing Guide sees it as a way to learn problem-solving skills in all areas of life.
I love to watch people get introduced to it. I love to watch people take it farther as well. I love just seeing people experience it and come away with some sense of accomplishment. Most people perceive rock climbing as an extreme sport, but in reality, it's pretty safe. Occasionally, rock fall happens naturally, and generally, that's more of a bigger type of rock fall. Our helmets may not protect us against that. But I would just really focus on the attributes, the challenge, the beauty of being outdoors, seeing the rock, the view from middle of the cliff or the top of a cliff, you know, whether it's 200 feet or 2,000 feet, is amazing.
See you guys up there.
But one of the best things that I've learned from rock climbing is problem solving. And that just goes into the rest of my life where a lot of obstacles that I encounter don't seem that drastic. Rock climbing for me is really a mental and physical challenge. So that's what really drives me is trying to challenge myself to do the best that I can. I enjoy the same thing in my other career as a woodworker. I take on very complicated, complex woodworking projects that just challenge me to figure out how to do things, to do it correctly, to do it efficiently, not make mistakes, and develop a really good product. I'll keep rock climbing as long as I can, so as long as my body lets me. And if that's 70 or 75, that's great. You know, if I can push myself even farther, I will. I might not climb as hard or as fast, but I certainly will try.
Our next story is about a Maine artist and glassblower who finds inspiration in music and the Rocky Coast.
All great artwork is storytelling. So you're trying to tell a story. It could be a humorous story, you know, it could be a tragic story. And not everything that you make, you know, is a significant story. I think a lot of my inspiration comes from natural things, the ocean. I mean, you can't live on the coast of Maine and not be affected by the tides and the full moon and the water. The chandeliers that I'm working on are more sort of garden and plant oriented right now. I think for me, one of the interesting things about the glass was that it was so fluid. And here's something that's just so hot and juicy and drippy, and you can throw colors on it. I mean, it's such a kid material. Glows in the dark, it sticks to itself. You know, you can stretch it, you can break it. It seemed so interesting. I think working quickly is important because you want that spontaneity, you want that freshness with the work. You don't want it too contrived. You want to have it be not chaotic, but something that's a loose sense of perfection. And if you make everything perfect, you know, you sort of lose the variety that's sort of there naturally. In the work that I do, music is a big part of it. You know, the beat, different colors you might feel from certain types of music, that's influential. I like the jazz, you know, rock and roll. I felt that nothing separates the generations more than the music they listen to. So as an exercise, I started to listen to rap music. Some of my friends that came in, you know, they say, what the hell is he listening to, you know? I can't stand that stuff. I think probably my greatest hope would be to live a long time and have the opportunity and the health in order to make a lot of interesting work. And to be able to have a portion of that set aside for family, you know, sons and grandsons and granddaughters.
After years of barely breaking even, this group of Port Clyde fishermen took control of their future by working together and set a new model for fishermen everywhere.
We caught an awful lot of fish for cheap. I think doing things like the CSF or what we're trying to do here, this project, it's just trying to create a new model. It's saying, no, that's not as cheap as dirt. It's worth a little more than that, and it's got to be treated with a little more respect. The groundfish fishery got severely depleted. It was because the only way that was seen to make it work was, okay, fish are 5 cents a pound, so the one thing we do have left is to sell quality, and you have to seek out the right market for that quality.
We started the co-op because we were fishing, what year was it, 2008. We couldn't turn a profit because fuel prices were almost $5 a gallon and our fish prices were around a dollar. The fish were selling in, say, grocery stores to the consumers for a high price. You know, we're getting a dollar and people are paying, you know, $10 to $15 a pound. So we decided to skip out that middleman who obviously isn't throwing us a bone.
You gotta be competitive. That drives you, you know. That's one of the natural highs you get out of it. And don't let anybody tell you they're not, because everybody is.
We were basically tired of being dictated to by someone else who was controlling our lives. So we wanted to take charge of all aspects of the fishing operation, from catching to processing to marketing and selling. CSF is a community supported fishery, that's what it means, CSF. It's based on the agricultural model, CSA, which means community supported agriculture. What it is community people or people in your region or area or state invest in shares of the catch.
The concept was very intriguing, being an environmentalist. You're getting it not 3 or 4 weeks old, but you're getting it that week. If you keep the money locally, then it gets spent locally, whereas if you buy something that's imported from somewhere else, then that means your money's gone and it's not staying around to support the local community.
These are people that I grew up with, that live down the road, so knowing that I'm able to buy something from them that'll keep their livelihood going, and hopefully generations down the road, it's important for me. I feel good about it. I'm able to talk with them at times. I've even been called when they're catching the fish on the boat, and they'll call me. I remember one halibut I had from 80 miles offshore, and I put it on the menu. This is 80 mile halibut. It's exciting for people to know where it's actually coming from. It makes them feel connected in a way, I think.
It takes a lot of commitment and courage to do this. Out of our co-op members, not everybody has elected to stay in. Some of them have decided that, no, we don't want to be part of that aspect of it anymore because it seems too risky. This model has been copied and continues to be in so many places around the country and in other countries. People trying to do exactly what we're doing here because they did it first in Port Clyde. So I guess as far as support goes, you couldn't get a larger compliment that you are doing the right thing, or at least trying to, when you get that many people trying to do the same thing that you are. It's kind of incredible to watch.
Our last story is about a collector in Maine and his unique treasures that he plans to put on display for everyone to enjoy.
You know, it starts with the very basic premise that there's no place like home, which I think is a very valid, very touching one. For me, what I always loved about the story, both the book and the movie, is that it's about, it really is an identity search. It's about a group of eccentric characters, a scarecrow, a tin man, and a lion, who are all searching for something that they already have. And although that sounds very basic, on the one hand, it's also very profound. About 2 years ago, I decided that 35 years in Los Angeles was enough, and I moved to Camden, Maine. I continue to work in the film business. One of the things, however, that keeps me sane is I own the world's largest Wizard of Oz collection. I'm planning to open a private museum in Camden, Maine, exhibiting my collection, which is about 50,000 items. At the moment, almost everything is in boxes. It's not really worth taking out until the museum sort of takes shape. I had always wanted a costume from the film, and about 15 years ago, Jerry Marin, who played the Lollipop Guild Munchkin, the Munchkin that hands Dorothy the lollipop, his costume came up for auction, and it's the most complete costume that has survived from the film because MGM reused a lot of those costumes and got rid of a lot of those costumes because they were very fragile and they were only made to be used for one movie, even though they did end up being used in other movies. Dorothy's dress, which is also sort of an iconic piece of movie costume history, went through a lot of revisions. So there are a lot of dresses that were called test dresses, which are dresses that used the same fabric, the famous blue gingham fabric, but they tried different, you know, straps, they tried different, sort of, you know, the constructions of the bodice, etc. And I have the last test dress before they decided on the permanent design. Plus, I have the blouse that she wore during the first 2 weeks of filming, because there was a director named Richard Thorpe who directed for about 2 weeks and was replaced. And they scrapped almost all of that film material and started from scratch. I mean, it was a movie that was, you know, a lot of people will say it's one of the most perfect movies ever made, but it was perfect by accident because it had four or five directors, it had many screenwriters. It was not necessarily a troubled production, but it was a production that went through a lot of different, you know, permutations. I think the majority of people still know the world of Oz through the MGM movie, and yet there's so much more. So people come in and see the collection, and I have heard from many, many people, oh, there was a book? Yes, there was a book. There was this, and this. So there is a way of sort of sharing that whole what there is quality with it that I enjoy as much as collecting it and having it in my own possession.
We hope you've enjoyed these unique, surprising, and compelling stories from right here in Maine. There are many more to tell. After all, everyone has a story. I'm Elizabeth Greenberg at Maine Media Workshops in College. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Maine Frame.